Welcome once again to the lecture number 17 of the deep learning course. In this session, we are going to talk about the image processing. That is a very important part because next thing that are going to come are related to the image understanding, that how can we process the image. So what are the basic? If we understand those kind of basis, then we would be able to appreciate that what is actually happening into the domain. So this is an example of an image. So you can see that. Can anybody tell that what this image is? This image is, I think there is some actor, Hollywood actor. Can anybody tell what is his name? Arnold. So this is an image, but actually there are some X side and Y side. If you think that, however, the coordinate system of the image start from this particular point. This is the X and this is the Y. So if you are here, you can very correctly think that, for example, this is the pixel number, let's 150 142. Let's assume that this is the location of this particular item. So what is the intensity at this particular place? If I can find out the intensity, and if let's assume that there is a function, and this function is actually the image, okay, that given some location, that what is my location, this gives you that what is the real value at that particular place. However, this is not the real value, this is an integer that is going to be given to you. An integer is a, you can also think that it is a natural number, and the range is from 0 to 255, and the minimum value is 0 and maximum value is 255. Grayscale image. So image that you can see over here can be represented using a function where when you supply a particular location, it is going to give you that what is the intensity at that particular location. If you see this particular three-dimensional representation of the image, can you understand that what this, whether this is the Arnold? Any idea, any clues? No. So that's why this is difficult for the computers to understand, because computers are seeing this kind of hills and valleys instead of this kind of representation. Somehow, computers should also understand that what this hill and valleys mean and how it is related to the Arnold. This is what my problem is. Basic problem is this. Image, as I told you, can be understood as a function that is coming from R cross R, and it's going to provide another value that is going to be R. If you want to find out, for example, this particular pixel location, that what is the value over here, how can you find out that? You have to go to the optics. You have to apply some kind of sampling. You have to find out that what is the intensity at that particular place. Maybe you can, you would be deploying some kind of lens and lens system where there would be some place where the image is going to be formed, and using the intensity of using some kind of sensor, you can find out what is the intensity at that particular place. Let's assume that the intensity is, possible intensities are this, and the intensity that you are going to measure at this particular point is this. Let's assume that this is the actual intensity. But since you are measuring using some kind of camera, you are deploying a kind of camera that is going to measure that what is this particular value. There could be some error into the camera, small kind of error or noise. Noise would definitely be there because noise is a fundamental property of any system. So there would be some noise. And therefore, however, this is the value, but there is some tolerance limit that you can get any value into this particular range. Either you can get this value or this value or this value, and that depends upon the noise. You cannot predict anything. So you would be getting this value. So all the possible values which are there, here we can divide into various thresholds. So we can say that this is a zero level, this is a 255 level. And if the value comes out to be this much, I would take to this particular thing. It's called the quantization, maybe upper or lower limit, whatever you wish. We can do a kind of quantization on that. So we have to do the quantization and sampling when you are going to consider the image. So this is the fundamental thing, how the image has been formed, okay? Since it is a function, we can apply some kind of operator on this particular image. And what could be the operator? Let me define this particular function. Can you read this, that what this particular function means? Just try to see this formula. Very simple formula that that says that gx is equal to fx plus 20. Okay, so the gx means another image. Let's assume that I'm going to make another image. So this is the image g, this is the image f. Let's assume that image f was there, and now you are creating another image g. And what is the everywhere 20 is added? What would happen? You can see that the new image that is going to come, it is going to be more brighter than the previous one. Okay, clear, this effect is clear. And this second image is more clearer, more brighter than the previous one. Okay, similarly, just consider this particular operation where I'm going to tell that gx is equal to f minus x. F minus x means the location. You can understand that this is the reverse direction of the thing. So what I'm telling here, that this pixel is going to be present at this particular place, and similarly their location is going to be exchanged. Okay, so if I exchange the location of all these things, this image becomes this image. Understand? So whether they got changed, mostly not, same thing. Okay, so very, very surprising thing we sometimes get with the images, that even if some value I'm going to change, but things are not changing. For the computer, if something I'm going to add or divide something, it should change, but it's not changing anything. If you go deeper and try to understand, we can define this as a point operations. What do I mean by point operation? That if some value you have, for example, there is some value called R you have, and you apply some kind of operation, for example, I'm going to represent it as a M. There is some operation that I'm going to apply, point operations. So if you apply point operation on this particular thing, you are going to get something that is S. So instead of using the value R, I'm going to use the value S. Can I apply something like this? Once again, R was the value. For example, this was an image at some place, there was a value. If I find out that what is the value, it is R. Instead of using R, what I'm going to do, I'm going to apply a kind of operator on that. And whatever new value is going to be there, I'm going to use that thing. It is called the point operations on the values. Let us try to understand some of the point operations, okay? So let's focus on this. This is something. Just focus for 1 minute. It's very important to understand. So what this image is? So on one side, let's assume this is R, means what is the original value. Another side, that there is S, that what is the new value, okay? Let us try to understand. So if I draw a line like this, what does it mean? This line means, if this is the value, then what is the value of S? Same value, okay? Because same value I'm going to get. But if I say that, okay, no, I'm going to change something. What I'm going to change, instead I'm going to use this line. Instead of the previous line, this line, I'm going to use this line. What would happen? Differently, you can say that when I'm considering this particular place, when I'm going to consider this particular place, so earlier the value was this much, but now the value would be this. If I use this particular line, the value would be this much. What do I mean by this? That actually I get this particular value. Instead of this value, I get this value. Now the value have reduced. This particular function, this particular line, this particular transformation, this particular point operation has done what? That it has reduced the value. Okay. All right. So, and one thing you can also see that these values, which were earlier this much, means this much, they become zero. They all become zero. Okay. So the initially some portion of the thing becomes zero. And after that, you get a kind of, I think there is a kind of slope also. You can see that here the slope is different, not 45 degree. So they are a kind of modified, but the value is lesser than this. As if you compare, the value is modified. So this, what this particular thing is going to give you? This was the original thing, but now your value is this. And if this is the value, it is higher value. And now you are representing this with the lower value. So what is the effect? That all the few, these things, these values become zero. Means they are, their brightness is reduced. Okay, they are less, they become zero brightness, with the zero brightness. And for all other points which have the brightness earlier this, now their brightness has reduced. So what is the effect of this particular operation? It is a darkening effect. Okay. Similarly, this, try to see this thing. Okay. Here also you can consider the same way, that there is a 45 degree line, and with respect to the, what is going to happen, for example, this was the thing earlier, the value was this, and now the value becomes this. So you are going to increase the value. The effect is lightening. Why there is a plateau over here? Why there is a plateau?
Maximum
after 255 is the maximum value, na? You know that the maximum value is 255. If some, for this thing value becomes 255, then from next one again you cannot increase the value. Okay, So this thing becomes plateau. Let's assume that this is the maximum value, 255. So this is how this is changing. So what is the effect of this thing? It is lightning. Okay, you can see that by this we have achieved the lightning effect. In this, let's assume that this is a 45 degree thing, and here you see the another line that is going to be upper. What is going to happen? The dark thing are compressed, because whatever the dark thing were earlier, you have whatever the dark values were there, they are compressed. Things are compressed toward the dark. Okay, because values, dark things are compressed. Less dark things would be there. There would be more brighter things. Similarly, here all the values are going to be reduced. So light things which were actually more light, they are actually compressed. Okay, so compression of the light happened over here. Compression of the dark has happened over here. Less lighter things are there. They are compressed. Why they are compressed? Because all the values are, there is some relationship, because they would be somehow, there would be somehow linear scaling. So all the values would be there, but they you can differentiate between the two different value, the two different value into the original image for which you were earlier able to differentiate. Here also you are able to differentiate those values. Make sense? This is an interesting kind of thing where you can see that here you are doing less change, but here you are going to do the more change. So if you are going to do more change at this particular place, means something is important happening into this particular domain. So let's assume that there is some object, for example, something is there is some box, for example, there is a seam, there is some box, and this is a brown box. Okay, so brown box means mostly the value would be near about zero. Okay, and if you want to emphasize that what is written over there, so you can take this particular part to the frequencies, to the intensities which are there with respect to the box. The box would be highlighted. Okay, so you are increasing the contrast by this. What you are doing, you are increasing contrast at that particular place, and the whatever detail is over there, details are going to be more effectively visible. This is lowering the contrast. So for these places, the values, contrast is going to be lowered. Okay, here emphasizing the shadows, emphasizing the light. But because, as I told you, that if you shift it here, something more would be emphasized, something different would be emphasized. Okay, because this particular range is going to be emphasized. If you bring this here, so the things which are having this at this particular place light, they are going to be emphasized. Here emphasizing light means you are putting the light on the place where there was less light. Emphasizing shadow means the shadows, you are putting something, emphasizing the place where there was less light, shadows. Understand? A very important thing. This slide is very important. Okay, now let us try to discuss more about technical term. That is a very important concept that is called the histogram. What is a histogram? Let's assume that this is an image. Okay, let's assume that this is an image, and this is actually colored image, but let us understand that it is not a, let's say that, let's consider it as a RGB. I have not told you that mostly the current the image could be grayscale. Okay, you can think extreme thing as a binary, where you say that if the threshold is something that greater than some value, you say that 255 or 0. Only two values are there. You can also represent by 0 and 1. Image can have all the pixel as a 0, 1. 1 means 255, 0 means 0 means 0. So that could have a very high contrast somewhere. You can see that you have seen there some, most of the time. For example, whatever writing you are writing on your copy, you are using a pen. So if it is either it is one color or other, inside, in between, there is nothing. Grayscale says that's when you use a pencil to put high pressure and low pressure. If very high pressure, it will become very dark, otherwise less dark. So you can think about the different kind of shades. So 255 different values you can have here, the grayscale image. So into the grayscale image, so value you are going to plot that particular value, you can use whatever color you wish. If you can use red, you can use green, you can use blue. And if you create three different channels, three different values, that RGB, all the three are represented. And using, for example, on one pixel, there is three different LEDs are going to be put at one pixel location, and their brightness is being controlled by these three channels. So now you can generate more colors, colorful images. So this is how different kind of colors are going to be produced. So let us focus on this particular thing. Let's assume that my color is grayscale. For our practical purposes, this processing on this image is nearly equivalent to going to the different kind of having more channels. So if you have an image that is RGB, mostly when you do a processing, what you do that you, for example, at this particular position, you want to find out what is the value. Go and see what is the value of R, what is the value of G, what is the value of B, and then find out the summation divided by number of items, that is 3. You find out the average at this particular place. So any colored image can be converted to the grayscale image. This is one way. However, this is not the perfect way. There are some weights are also associated. If you multiply using those things, you are going to get the better image. So assume that this is a grayscale image. Assume that this image is a grayscale image, converted to the grayscale image. So what would be the pixel values? Okay, so pixel value could be 0. Pixel value could be 255. This is the maximum value. And if I find out that, for example, here I write count how many values are going to have the 0, are having this value 0. You can find out, I'm not sure, this means this much. How many of them having 255, this much. How many of them are going to have the 150, maybe this much. 1, 2, 3, 4, just count that how many of them. How many of them are which values? If you count that how many of them are going to have this value, so you can come this kind of chart that is called as a histogram. What is it called? Technically called histogram. This is called the histogram. So for this image, let's assume that this is what the histogram of this thing. Okay, now I have a question. If I use a different image, if I take a different image over here, okay, if I take a different image over here, so whether the histogram would be same? No, histogram would be different. So if there are multiple images, and I want to find out which image is this, I can utilize this histogram to find out the similarity. Okay. Histogram are a way to represent the image. So if you want to find out the similarity between two images, we can use this thing. Let me give you one more thing. We have few minutes back we have seen that we can do some kind of point operations. So one point of operation we have seen that whatever value of was there earlier, I am going to use something to that. If I use this thing, what would be the new histogram? Can you tell me? It would be shifted, okay? So this value becomes this value becomes there, everything is there. So the same thing would be shifted, okay? You can see that the similar kind of operation, similar kind of thing is happening. So means looks like that this histogram represents the image, okay? This is another intuition that you can think that it is representing the thing. That's why you can utilize this to find out the similarity. Understand? Okay. However, histogram, sometimes histograms are actually very important handles to actually improve the image. What do I mean by this? There is something called the histogram equalization. What does it mean? Because we are actually visualizing the thing. From the human perspective, we are visualizing. If these values are not available, then it's a good thing. If a good image is there, everything should be there. Nah? Nice that every shade should be there. If everything is only one thing, what does this mean? If I have all the images of this particular intensity, brightness, what would happen? Nothing. You can find out nothing. Let's assume that I give you one image that has the intensity. Let me write down the line. Let's assume that I have two lines. Let me say that 0 to 255. Okay. I give you this image. What do I mean by this? That all the pixels are going to have this intensity. For example, 100. All the intensities are going to have this value, say 150. Does they have any meaning? No, it's a clean image. Okay, one intensity is only there. So this doesn't make any sense. So if the few things are not there, it would be nice that if somehow we can find out these intensities also. So there is one operation that is called the histogram equalization that says that let's assume that this is the minimum value and this is the maximum value. So you can take the minimum to the 0 and you can take the maximum to the 255. Okay, and if there is some value, for example, this is let's assume that it is going to be 100 to 180, let's assume that these are the intensities available, and there is some intensity 120, you want to find out what should be the intensity of this particular thing. Okay, so you can I think this is a very easy for you to find out. Just see that what is the range. It is 180 minus 100, it is range is 80. Out of this 80 range, how much you have expanded to 0 to 255, so maximum is 255. How much difference is here? Only 20. It is 120 minus 100, so it is 20. So what should be the right value of 20? It is 20 multiplied by 255 divided by 80. Okay, this should be the new intensity of this 120. Am I right? Okay, makes sense. It's general min max normalization. It is just a min max normalization that I have done. So min max normalization, using min max normalization, if you apply, this thing becomes this. Any problem in this? However, there is a small technical problem with this thing. So these things are not going to change. Actually, I think I must have placed this into this particular way. The same intensity, because number of intensity are not going to change. Frequency are not going to change. It will be something like this. Okay. So this, they are not going to reduce. This value is not going to reduce. There will be some values which would not be there. Because look what happens now when I'm going to scale this up, so some new values would become zero. Okay, so there would be some gaps, so it cannot be the directly it cannot be the this kind of continuous thing. There would be some gap when I'm going to apply the histogram equalization. There would be some gap. So we are going to see an example where everything would be clear. So most of the time we utilize the cumulative histogram distribution function, and that is just, we have just talked about the brief idea over here. And then we can do this kind of histogram equalization. What does it mean? Okay, let me give you an example. See this image. Okay, let's assume that this is the image. Is it a good image? I don't know. Let us try to see that what is the histogram. Looks like the histogram is only this. Okay, histogram is this. If we say that I am going to apply this kind of change. Okay, if I say that I'm going to apply this kind of curve on this. However, we have few minutes back talked about that the curve should be linear, where the min max normalization is there. But if I say like this, it means that few items which are there, I'm going to highlight them. So without loss of generality, we can understand that this thing has been converted to this thing. Make sense? Here you can see that there are few values which are not present. So this, the previous histogram has been converted to this histogram. If you use this histogram and draw again the image becomes this. Do you see the difference? Very good image. This is one operation, that from this image we have actually reached to this particular image. See another image. This is an image. This is actually, I don't know that. Can you understand that what is there? Again, the same kind of technique we are going to apply. We are going to find out that what is the histogram. This is what the histogram we have. So you can see that few values are here also, very small values. Somewhere the high intensity values are there. So there is also a general technique that sometimes you actually neglect these things. And for this portion only, you apply histogram equalization. Otherwise, histogram equalization would be bad. Maybe you can apply again this kind of histogram equalization. So when you apply this kind of histogram equalization, you got this histogram, new histogram. Okay. So now you can see that all the things are there, 0 to 255, all the values are there. And if you do this, you get this image. So how you think that whether this is a better image? Okay, if you compare the previous one, try to see that what is the effect of this thing. This was the previous image, this is the new image. Just you can see that how much difference we are able to achieve. Okay, this is a technique called histogram equalization. Let me give you a very strange idea. I am going to do something very bad, drastic. What I'm going to say that, take this pixel, exchange their values. Take this pixel, exchange their value. Take this pixel, exchange their value. Do it so many times. What would happen? You would get this image. Are you sure? You would get this image. From this image, you'd become this image. Are you sure? Randomly, you have shuffled the image. So all the pixels are shuffled. So this is the image that you are going to get. There would not be any continuation. Pixels are shuffled. So you would be getting this image. Okay. If you get this image, and if you have this image, try to come up with a histogram whether they are same or not. They are same, but whether these images are same? No. Similarly, you can see here. Here is a panda image done the something like this. You cannot come up with any kind of understanding of this image. Both have the same histogram. So histogram, few minutes back we had talked that we can utilize it as a feature, but looks like that. No, these two images have the same histogram, but they are not similar at all. Understand? So patches of the images, if you can even with the patches of images, you can play, you can change the things, the output is going to be very, very different. And however, their histogram is going to remain the same. So we need more local operators. If we want to compare two images, this is our task. Okay, we want to find out that what is into the image. So therefore, we have to do the comparison. So some more local operators are actually needed. Histogram, however, represents the image, but at a very, very high level. It is not the characteristic feature. Try to understand. Okay, so is it clear? Okay, please. There is a question. Sir, could you explain the zebra vs panda slide again? Okay. So this zebra slide, you understand? Can you write yes, Prabhu? Okay.
Yes, sir.
This is a zebra slide. I am going to do an operation. What operation? That randomly I am going to shuffle some of the pixels. This pixel, and I am going to randomly shuffle the pixels. Okay. This pixel and this pixel, I am going to shuffle. I am going to do it multiple number of times. Prabhu, are you able to listen to me? Can you say yes? Yes,
yes
or no,
sir.
Prabhu?
His voice is not audible.
Please don't speak because I have muted there. You can please type. Okay. Because if I start allowing the speaking, so there would be an echo. Okay. So you understand? So my question is, Prabhu, that whether this image would become this or not? Yes or no? This would become this or not? Yes? Similarly, this would become this. Okay, this part is clear. My point was this, that the histogram of both the images are going to be the same. So earlier I was telling that we can use histogram to characterize the image. This is actually wrong. We cannot use that. Okay. Clear? Okay. So first thing that we have to do is to tackle with the noise that is there. Okay. First thing that I wanted to do into the image processing is to tackle with the noise that is there. What is the noise? So you know that if there is, as I few minutes back told, the 0 to 255 values are available. Okay. However, you are given, let's assume that your camera is going to give you that on this pixel, this value is there. As I told you that there is also a error term where we expect that the mean is zero and there is some variance, Gaussian distribution, noise is there. So this particular, instead of getting this value, you are going to get this particular value. So actual values are going to be disturbed everywhere. What I can do with that? What I can do? How can we make the correction on that? The first thing we are going to see that how we can do the correction. Okay. And the idea is very simple, that since we have thought that this noise had the zero mean. Okay. So if we find out the summation across different values, the noise will be cancelled out. So the best idea is, for example, these are the values that I'm going to get at a particular pixel. So what I should do, that with respect to the time, I put a kind of, I can put a kind of mask, 111. So previous value zero, here value zero, 111. Whatever value here was there, I multiplied by one and find out the summation, divide by the number of items which are there were one. So if I want to find out that what should be the value at this particular location, instead of using the current value, I should use this particular function. So if you have the initial, let's assume that you come up with this value, and then after that you are going to change this thing to this one. Okay. So this is the one idea. You can see that this curve is, if you compare this curve and this curve, you can see that the second curve is going to have more smooth operator. So it is going to tell you better things. Okay. This is the one way to first stabilize our signal. And sometimes people say also that instead, because you are thinking that what is just now coming may be given higher weight and these things could be given lesser weight. It is also possible. Maybe some Gaussian, because whatever value here can be given the more weight previous and other things lesser weight. So you can apply a weighting function also. When you are going to find out the summation, at that time you can apply the weighting also. And then you take the average and say that what is the next value that is going to be. This particular function is called the kernel function. And using this kind of kernel function, again, our task was to smoothen the image. Our task was to smoothen the value that we are going to get. Very interesting operation that we can find out from here is this. Let's assume that this is an image. All the values are zero. Here the values is 90. Okay. What does it mean? Can you relate it to anything? So it is a wall. You can think that there is a wall. In wall, there is a small window. So window is you are seeing something from outside. The values are 90. Here the values are zero. Fine. Let's assume that I give you this image where this value is zero and this value is 90. Is it a right image? Mostly not. One pixel. How come one pixel become 90? How come one pixel become zero? Nearby nothing is zero. Nearby values are high. Looks like that this is going to be a problematic thing. Okay. Can we utilize the previous method that we have used? Can we use a filter over here? And can we multiply with this thing? So the filter could be that if I use, for example, I'm going to tell you a very important thing. Please focus on this. So I say that I am going to utilize this particular size of filter. Okay, what do I mean by this? Two-dimensional filter I'm going to use. A few minutes back, we were talking about one-dimensional filter. I'm going to say, and I am going to use this size filter. Okay, what do I mean by filter? That there are some values. Okay, let's assume these values are 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. When this filter is multiplied to any particular place, for example, I want to find out what should be the value over here. Forget about what is right now. Okay, you pick this particular portion only and you multiply with this particular thing. So 0 is multiplied by 1. Once again. So 0 is multiplied by 1, 0 is multiplied by 1, 90 is multiplied by 1, 90 is multiplied by 1, this 0 is multiplied by 1. You can find out term by term multiplication. And this is the f multiplied by g and then divided by 1 upon it. To find out the average, and whatever value you get, you are going to put at this particular place. This is an operation. The previous, why? What was the idea? Using this kind of idea. Here the things were one dimension, and I'm going to apply it to the two dimension. This filter. What would happen? What would give me? So here some value which are actually zero, they get some value, but think about this zero. This zero becomes what? 50. It is better value. Instead of having 90, this is a better value. Okay. See, this was 90 surrounded by other zeros. What it becomes? This becomes 10. This is better value. So this is a better representation. Instead of previous thing, this is the better representation. Again, the formula, you can see that there is a summation term that is going to come term by term summation and going to find out. And here, instead of 1, you can assume the values are 1 by 8. So outside 1 by 8 need not to be here. Because we have defined a function like that. Make sense? So you understand that this is going to give you a smoothing effect. Very good thing we are discussing, okay? So this, let's assume that this is the image I have. And if I apply a kernel, what would happen? Actually, what would happen? This is the image. Whether this is a good image? No. Once again, let me give you what I told you. Let's assume this is the monkey that is sitting in front of you. I don't know, I might be wrong. It is not monkey. Can you tell me what is this? I don't know. In India, we don't find this thing. So maybe, can anybody write? Okay. So let's assume that there is a monkey sitting in front of you and you have actually applied a camera on him. Whatever value you are going to get, let's assume whatever value. Few minutes back, I told you that you don't use this value, apply a filter, because filter would smoothen the value, and therefore you are going to get this thing. Oh, what I mean, that this was the original thing, but you got this thing. Your system is going to capture this thing, and it would be given to you. You would not be able to find out this thing. Try to understand this fact. Able to understand that the emails that you are going to get are going to have this particular kind. Maybe this year we have applied the bigger kernel and it is not going to be that big, but mostly this is going to happen. All right, few minutes back I have talked about that this, if you just focus on this particular kernel, so all the values were 1 1 1 1 1 1 1 1, but instead you can also apply a kind of other functions also. So most probabilistic, most used values are going to be Gaussian one, where what does that mean? That if I say that let's assume that this is the kernel, I say that this is a 0 0 location, this is the 1 0 location, this is the 2 0 location, this is the 2 1 location, this is the 2 2 location. Similarly, it is a -1 0 location, it is a -1 -1 location. You can find out that what is the location. That is no problem. What should be the value at this particular place? Take the value of x and y and apply and put it in this particular function. 1 upon 2 pi sigma square e to the power x square plus y square upon 2 sigma square. If I define this sigma, and here the mu is actually kept to the zero. If I define this particular sigma, so it is going to give you some value over here. Okay, some value, that what value should be here. So instead of 1, if you use this particular function, that is the Gaussian function, to find out the value, then this the kernel is going to be called a Gaussian kernel. Gaussian kernel is a low pass filter. Why? We would come back to this once again and see that how come it is a low pass filter. So this kind of function would be there. So if earlier I was talking about that you are going to use 1 1 1, instead if we use the Gaussian of 3 cross 3, this could be the value. Of 5 cross 5, this could be the value. Of these are the different size filters. We can apply different size of filters on that. Instead of using 1 cross 1, what I'm telling, that don't use 1 cross 1. Instead use what? Gaussian one. Understand? Now, what I told you a few minutes back, this was the original image. Actually, you are going to get this thing. Instead of the using Gaussian one, if you 1 1 1, if you use the Gaussian one, and this thing is called the actually box filtering, the name is box filtering. Instead of using the box filtering, if you apply the Gaussian filtering to smoothen, you would be getting this image. All right, whether this is a better image or not, it is a better image. Okay, instead of using the box filtering, apply the Gaussian filtering. Okay. Gaussian filter, this operation that we have few minutes back done, that using some kind of kernel and multiplying and finding out the value, this operation is called the convolution operation. Okay, convolution, this is also called the convolution. Given an image, you apply a kernel, and after that you got something, that is, this operation is called the convolution. After convolution, you are going to get this thing. Okay, this is going to be again very important when I'm going to talk about the CNN. In the CNN, convolutional neural network. This is coming like that. This is a very big image, and in this image, I have taken this part to this place. You can go and visit. And randomly, I have put some part. For example, I have cut this particular part. Okay, I have cut this particular part. I'm not sure about this. I also forget that from where I cut this particular part. Okay, let's assume that I want to find out where is this thing. Where is this thing into this particular image? The idea would be that you put it here, you use this particular mask and put it everywhere and try to see that what is the response at that particular place. At the location where this particular item is there, I'm not sure about this, the value is going to be maximum. So by this, you can actually find out that where is that particular object is. Object localization, you can apply this kind of operation. Very interesting thing. Next very interesting idea is the Fourier transform. And Fourier was a very funny kind of person, I would say that. He was a very good mathematician. Let me, what we say that sometimes we say that we touch our ears when we say like that. No? So I'm calling him funny, but he had done a very fundamental thing, and I find it very funny. What is this? He told that if you can bring me any signal, I can convert it into the sine and cos. So everyone was, it was it was a very what I say that this destructive kind of idea. Any function, given any function, can I transform this to the sine and summation of sine and cos? They told yes. If you have any function, I can convert it into the summation of sine and cos waves only. So if you have a sine wave, then you can say that there is a sine wave. But if it is not a sine wave, how can you convert it into a sine wave? He told that, okay, not one sine wave, collection of the infinite sine wave and cos wave, I can convert like that. There was one more caveat. He told that if there is a function that is periodic, okay, means after some time it is going to be the same. So for those function only I can do this. Okay, if people ask that, how can you do this for anything? He told that I can do it this for only periodic signal. So I told you that, then I got satisfied, okay, that he has some flaws, technical flaws, that he can only do the things which are actually periodic. But again, he had come with another idea that if your signal is non-periodic, for example, your signal is not periodic, okay, it is going to be anything like that. So he said that I would assume that it is going to be repeated after some time, because you are going to give me signals for this particular time. I would assume that after this time, after when my experiment is going to end, after that, the same signal is going to repeat once again. And it is not going to me. By using this idea, every signal is now periodic. And therefore, he can do every signal he can transfer into the sine and cos. I will not go into much detail because this is beyond the scope of this particular class. You should only understand this if he come up with this kind of sine cos differentiation. So what does this mean? That is, he give various sine waves. For every sine and cos wave, there is some amplitude. So let's assume that in this side, and say every sine and cos wave is going to have a frequency and amplitude. So let's assume that there is a plot where one side there is a frequency. So for all the frequency, if this is the frequency, what is the amplitude of this frequency? I am going to write with this. So this, whatever signal you have, the signal can be represented with this kind of diagram, where it is a frequency representation of the same signal. It is a time domain representation. This is a frequency domain representation of the same thing. Where, what are the frequency? Given this kind of signal, he is going to tell me that these are the frequencies available and what is their amplitude. I am going to plot those amplitude onto the frequency line, and I say that the signal has been converted from the frequency domain to the from the time domain to the frequency domain. Any signal I can transform. Very interesting thing is this, that sometimes this is an important property for Fourier transform, that if there is a Fourier transform of some mathematical multiplication thing, so Fourier of first thing and Fourier of second thing can be taken as an account. And then if you, for example, if f and g are two things, they are multiplied, we can find out Fourier of first and second. This is going to be like this. And if you want to find out what is this thing, then you can take the inverse. Once again, somehow, if this thing is available to you, then you can find out g by taking the inverse of that Fourier transform. So Fourier transform, you can also find out the inverse. You can hear, and there is a property of multiplication. So two signals, if you know that what is their Fourier transform, you can multiply, and this multiplication is very easy because here only few number of terms would be there. Multiplication is easy, and then we can reconstruct something. What do I mean by this? Let's assume that this is an image, okay? So I can represent this image like this. If there is some filter, this kind of filter, I can multiply over here. And this filter is going to give me this thing. What is the significance of this thing? The significance of this particular operation is this, that sometime, look, into the communication domain, the importance of Fourier transform is this, that let's assume that in your signal, you find out that these are the components. You know that you have to transform this, you have to transmit this thing to somewhere. If you want to transmit, you know that you are going to transmit using some kind of wire. Wire cannot transmit anything more than having frequency more than this. And he cannot also transmit anything that is have frequency greater than this. Definitely, only these things are going to be important. And only this is you can reconstruct at the other side. If you start processing and you are going to utilize this portion also, it is going to take a lot of your effort. But ultimately, these things are not going to be any fruitful because they are not going to reach to the other end. And definitely, it would be nice that if you can drop these components, your computation would be lesser, you would be more effectively able to go ahead with the processing. So sometime, if we want to find out another aspect of something, for example, if this is a image, I want to find out some, do some kind of operations. And for example, I want to find out some kind of salient feature. I can say that, just see that what is the, because if there is an elephant, if I draw a line, you can tell that this is an elephant. You need not to be the, see the elephant itself, okay? If there is mouse, I draw a line using a sketch, you can say that it is mouse. So line is only important. In between, details may not be important, just to, if sometime if you want to understand that thing. So if we have a filter that removes all those parts which are actually not relevant to us, then we can focus on that particular part which is important to us. So this is the filter that is going to be multiplied over here. So there was some filter. This was a filter. There was a filter, and this was the Fourier transform of that particular filter. Here we can remove some of the portion which are not important. We know that these things are not important. We can change, we can drop some of the components over here. We can multiply to the original image. In the original image, we got this thing. And if we reconstruct, so this image becomes this image, means this is more suitable for our processing. Are you able to understand this? If we apply processing on this image, you would not be able to be that good, because that is not needed. But if you apply the processing on this, you will be better. Why? Because unnecessary things are removed. Okay, unnecessary details are removed. Okay. You would come back once again. I think we have very less time. It is since we would stop at this particular point and continue into the next class on this particular point.